find someone who's got it. And, well, hey, I know. Trust me.
So where is your page?
It's Reset Media on YouTube.
So we're on YouTube?
We're on YouTube and Facebook. I discussed that with you, remember?
I'd like to address your issues.
Britt, so why don't, when we do an organized way to do this.
Each. Before. I was a board member at the Orange County Medical Association. We were doing some work for us.
So I'll go.
Excuse me.
I haven't hung out.
It's when I used to have hair. No, I'm just kidding.
Better with
that.
Thanks for agreeing to meet.
Yeah, and I'm really here to listen to you, okay? Yeah. Because I know this is an important issue for everybody, and so when I was asked to show up to meet with all of you, and that's what I wanted to do.
And we're grateful.
We agree to disagree, but at least talking.
I bet we agree more.
A lot more than you think.
I know you don't remember. I'm a certified primary care doctor. Been in practice forever.
Can you vote yes?
I've been treating COVID patients since the beginning. Hundreds and hundreds of COVID patients.
Just use this. You can see it through the side. Hold on. When it goes off, you just press that power button, okay? If the screen goes off, just press the power button once. Don't hold it down. Just once. Quick press.
Let me restate your statement. So you're saying right now, if you write a prescription, a pharmacy can essentially refuse to fill it?
They can. I'm not talking about based on their belief that what I'm writing isn't effective.
So the pharmacist there is overriding the decision of a
physician-patient
relationship?
Correct. And these are not narcotics. These are not controlled drugs. It's literally easier, for me to prescribe you OxyContin or Vicodin than it would be hydroxychloroquine or ivermectin. Now, I'm not here to argue whether hydroxychloroquine or ivermectin is effective or not. There's many of us that believe it is. We have studies to back it up. But regardless of whether you agree or you don't agree, my ability to use my judgment with my patient is blocked. CVS, Rite Aid, Walgreens, etc.
That is a very, very important relationship. Patient, physician. And if you sit there and you examine, you're a board-certified doctor, you know there's all the
correct
rules and regs of this great country in this day. And so that's your job to review that patient. And you're saying that pharmacist can cut you off from making that decision.
Yes, they can.
Is it all right if we have everyone just get a chance to say something in the beginning?
Yes, please.
Okay. Marah, can you speak with Lou and tell her your story?
So I'm new because my daughter was injured by the Pfizer vaccine 402 days ago.
Was injured?
Yes. And so she was one of the youngest people that was in the rollout wing.
How old was she?
So she's actually 20 at the time. She's a pre-med student at Chapman University. She was a Pope scholar, so she was volunteering at St. Joseph. And during that time, she was working on the COVID flu. So she was helping the nurses out, kind of step up or whatever. And in that, was given the opportunity to have the vaccine in January of last year. Speak louder now.
Yeah,
so in January of last year, everything changed. So her intention when she went to school was to go be a neonatal physician. That was the idea, right? But instead, having the Pfizer vaccine, that she took it because she understood that public colleges were going to mandate, medical school was probably going to mandate, keeping her job at the hospital was probably going to mandate, so she just stepped up and went ahead and did it. When she did that, we had probably over 100 blood labs drawn. We had spinal taps. We have had 12 MRIs. We've had every kind of test you can think of to figure out why.
She had the vaccine. Did she get actual COVID or no?
She did get COVID afterwards as well, down the road. So that's another story. But this child, who had perfect health, a photographic memory, which is what got her into 17 of the 17 schools she applied to, went from that to this laundry list. Nausea, fatigue, 104 fever for 6 days. She could feel her brain. No one should ever say they could feel their brain. She had excruciating pain in all of her extremities to the point where she would cry. She couldn't bend her joints without thinking about it. So she had to physically think, to bend, to walk, to do anything.
Is this when she had COVID or just for the
vaccine? I'm talking after the vaccine. All of this is after the vaccine. I'm not going to tell you.
Before COVID?
Before COVID. COVID she just had a couple months ago. Vaccine she had 402 days ago. she's had tremors in all of her extremities. So you ever see the videos where you see people doing this? This was my child. So she then lost her fine motor skills. She couldn't hold a pencil. She couldn't hold, chop her food. She couldn't button her clothes. She couldn't do anything.
I want to get your full name and telephone number because of HIPAA laws. I won't ask for your
I got everything for you and permission to speak. She'll get on the phone right now if you need. I got it all. The whole point of this is it ended up to the point from January on to July where then she started getting chest pains. And all of the issues that I said went even farther to we ended up in the hospital four times in a period of 4 days.
This is not a unique story.
I know this isn't unique. That's why I'm here. We were gaslit. The same exact scenario was told to us that we found out has been being told to doctors all around the world to tell their patients. But the end game here is my daughter thought she was dying because no one would help us. Because doctors are afraid to lose their license, so they won't speak out or speak up or do the next step. I know. But all the ones we didn't find you. Where were you? So in the end game, I made a post on Instagram. And that Instagram post went viral. Do you know how many seconds are in a day? 84,660.
I'm going to go behind him.
That's a lot of people. In a month. I mean, this is insane. But I found a parallel universe of people who were the same thing, gaslit. All of those tests that my daughter took, most of them came back with nothing wrong, yet my daughter can't get up, right? We finally found help through regenerative medicine, which, by the way, Vax is free, but none of the help was. So I'm out of pocket cash, $36,000 to save my kid.
It's not flattering.
Which is, I'm only one person, and my daughter is much better, but she is now temporarily disabled. She cannot hold a conversation. She cannot.
Is she getting any better?
She's physically better. So all of
I caught COVID and
yes.
I went through a lot of those same symptoms, which was the fogginess. You're talking and all of a sudden what was I about to say?
Exactly.
And it's getting better and better, but I'm blessed that I just decided right after I got COVID to just try to physically pound through it. I could feel myself before. Couldn't breathe as well as I used to. It was hard.
Did you get early treatment? Unfortunately, the standard treatment in too many areas is to stay home, isolate yourself, and then if you feel like you're going to die, show up to the hospital, and then they expedite that by giving you remdesivir, which is a very toxic chemical that late in the stages really offers minimal benefit. And that's part of the problem. We have early treatment. If you eliminated the controversial drugs, ivermectin, hydroxychloroquine, pretended like they don't exist, we still have very effective treatment with a sequential multi-drug treatment protocol that is out there that many of us are using. If we did nothing but educate people about vitamin D levels and boost people's vitamin Ds, we'd have better outcomes. We did nothing.
Dropping vitamin D like it's going out of business.
But you'll never hear, you'll never hear Dr. Fauci talk about it or any of the talking heads in legacy media. You'll never hear that. If we did nothing but educate people to use a nose throat rinse system with a virucidal like dilute hydrogen peroxide or betadine, if we did nothing but that, we could save lives, reduce the duration and symptoms. The problem is if I post that on social media, I'm blocked.
Right.
I'm called the quack. I have people that call the medical board today asking for my license to be removed because I advocate endless number of people.
Somebody who saw you on social media?
Do a lot of speaking on media and local churches and so forth, and I talk about early treatment for COVID.
It's been a while since I was in the state legislature, but they're not going to remove your license. You need to go through a new process.
You do. It's quite a hurdle. If the medical board comes against a doctor, I've got to pay for that myself. Malpractice does not cover action against the medical board. And the government, of course, has unlimited funds to harass, prosecute, and adjudicate a doctor's case. Now, fortunately, it's not happening because I don't think they're going to come after doctors because I don't think that's a case that they can win. But the threat of it is out there, the threat of writing a letter for somebody like her son, for example, so they don't get the vaccine, puts me at risk.
Where do you live?
I live in Rossmore. North Orange County, kind of East Orange County.
I used to represent you.
You did. It's by Seal Beach and Los
right
Alamitos.
Right next to Long Beach, right?
That's right.
Is it okay if we could have like Josh or John? They're here representing the fire department for freedom.
I want to follow up with you on this one.
I gave your assistant my card.
And I want to follow up with the medical board on your specific issues.
Yeah, I'd love to. I'd love to sit down with you offline.
You know, I had my three vaccines. Like I said, I got it. I got COVID.
And listen, I think you should be able to make that decision to be vaccinated or not.
But the issue that you're saying, which is these threats.
I brought one of my patients here today who's been vaccine injured. It happens. And so people should be making informed decisions with their doctor whether they get or don't get vaccinated, not mandated by government. It's wrong to do that. And our children, for God's sakes, our children, they're not at risk of COVID, not my opinion. 0% chance of death from COVID of children. Look at the CDC's data.
It's true.
But the schools are about to mandate that our little kids get vaccinated with an experimental product against a disease they're not at risk without any long-term safety studies. It just doesn't exist. It's wrong.
You know, they're studying that one to death right now at nauseam. They're trying to figure out what
As they should.
And I think that's what the parents also need to be part of that decision making.
They should, but there's a bill up in Sacramento right now that's going to take away parental rights and allow a 12-year-old to consent to a COVID vaccine. I mean, hell, they can't even decide what time they're going to go to bed at night or what they're going to have for dinner, but they're going to consent for a COVID vaccine? That doesn't make sense.
Gentlemen, may I?
Yeah.
You've been waiting, so.
Absolutely.
You guys are pretty good at projecting your voice.
Yeah.
You might explain also why we're here.
Yeah.
Why we're here.
I think it's the opportunity. You said earlier that conversation, that dialogue is what we're missing today, and I 100% agree. So I appreciate you taking the time to listen to what we have to say from the other side. I've always advocated for the conversation to happen. My name is Josh Sattley.
Can you step closer,
please? I was a Beverly Hills firefighter paramedic. Good to meet you, too. So I was a Beverly Hills firefighter paramedic for about 11 years. I've been a paramedic for about 14 years. And I served that community. It was a dream job for me. But 2 weeks ago, I was officially terminated from the city because I refused to be vaccinated. That was after I submitted a religious exemption and tried to go through their rules and their games or whatever they wanted to play. Hey, I tried to jump through all those hoops to try to save my job. And unfortunately, I was off the job since October 1st because I was too risky to be in the public's eye, too risky to be interacting with patients. Just on September 31st, there were thousands of firefighters in LA County that were, they're interacting with patients. And all of a sudden, October 1st, that's when the LA County health mandate came down. You had to be vaccinated or terminated unless you had a religious or medical exemption. So all of a sudden, the arbitrary date comes down, and I'm no longer allowed to work, and other people were forced to make that decision whether they want to be vaccinated or terminated. There was 22 exemptions submitted originally. 14 were accepted on a temporary basis. We made this decision solely after an interview that we had to sit through and tell her my deeply held religious beliefs and why it precluded me from having the vaccine. Besides that, I think as firefighters and first responders, we might have earned that choice to begin with. Like you said, I respect everybody's choice to do what they want to do with their own body. And from the beginning of the pandemic, we had zero protection. In the beginning, in fact, it was hard to find PPE, but we still showed up to work. We still helped individuals when they were asking for help. They call 911. We show up. We never have the ability to zoom in for a 911 call, whether it's structural fires or CPR or whatever it is. So we always showed up. Many of us contracted COVID during the first and second year. I did personally. And then so when this came up, we would ask them constantly, is there any discussion about natural immunity?
When did you get COVID?
I had COVID in January of 2021. I had it. Yeah. And then I just had the Omicron variant just last,
I had the first
December.
One about the same time you did.
Yeah. And
I had it again, but I got myself tested.
Sure.
To the best of my knowledge, I didn't.
Sure.
Who knows?
And so we took precautions. I mean, firefighters, we care about the community to the level that I'm willing to sacrifice my life for you to go into a burning building or to show up when you have COVID. Like, that's the risk that we take. And so as this thing played out, we could see the risks that we're getting into. My first call, I didn't know whether I was going to contract it and die or be able to go home and see my family. There's a lot of questions. But as it's played out and the information's come out and we've seen it personally firsthand, I think that we have the ability to make our own decision whether we wanted it or not. And if we had natural immunity, which was never a discussion. It was never on the table. It was vaccinated or medical or religious exemption. And there was a huge discouragement to even submit either one of those. As you heard before, religious or medical exemptions are near impossible to get for various reasons. And if you don't have a medical reason to get a doctor wrapping up, it's not possible. Nor would you ask for that. Secondly, if you have a religious belief, you should be protected under Title VII. However, in our city, they never gave me a reason why they denied my religious exemption. And I'm a deeply religious person. I grew up Christian my whole life, devout Christian. And it didn't seem to matter to this individual sitting across in the Zoom meeting who decided whether I could continue or not, or she was going to accept it. Never gave me a reason. And still to this day, never gave a reason, right? And she put me off the job October 1st. Since then, there's been hundreds of LA City firefighters also put off the job for refusing to be vaccinated. And in our line of work, there's much more dangerous things that we come across. I mean, if we get a traffic accident right here, standing in the street is much more dangerous than coming in contact with COVID for most of us, which are pretty healthy individuals. And of course, it's dangerous for a certain part of the population. I'm not saying that it's not. However, there's been zero studies to show that there's been transmission from a paramedic to a patient. And when I go on call, I wear the PPE, okay? I'm against it in this situation, coming to this building for different reasons, but on a call, I wear gloves, I wear glasses, I wear a mask. And I never was there to put anybody else's life in danger. But now all of a sudden, my future and my career was taken away from me by some, desk jockey, for lack of better words, some HR director who's been given these directions from city council and the city manager. And we don't have any leadership in the fire department that was willing to stand up against it and tell them.
You do have a member of firefighters union. You have certain rights.
Exactly.
And
you
even
said
if you're
earlier,
not a member of a union, you still have some rights too.
Exactly. They've been completely silent. So we've had zero protection from the unions. They never followed our due process. I was put off the job without pay October 1st. They never followed the Firefighter Bill of Rights, which is state law. They never followed our MOU, which is the contract.
You need a good attorney?
We have attorneys, but yes, we can always use good attorneys.
You know,
so we have lawsuits filed.
Absolutely.
So we do, and we filed a lawsuit back in December against the city of Beverly Hills, and recently we're amending it now to add the wrongful termination suit. I'm going to let John speak because he's also got a lot more to add to that. He's from the LAFD.
LAFD?
Yeah, so he represents a lot more
John
individuals.
John. I've been with the city of Los Angeles for almost 22 years, firefighter, paramedic. Prior to that, I worked for the county of Los Angeles as a reserve deputy sheriff. I've been in public service for almost 32 years, and like Josh said, throughout this whole pandemic, we answered the call. We did what was requested of us. We were never a problem. I've never had anybody tell me that because I'm not vaccinated or whatever, or anyone in our department, that's just not an issue. So, you were talking about, he said a lot already, so I'm not going to repeat what he said, but you're talking about due process, that they have due process, the doctors, they're not going to take their license. Well, they've already done that. They violated due process with us, okay? So in the state of California, as a public servant, especially police and fire, we have what's called a property right to our job versus, based on a Supreme Court ruling in the state of California called Skelly versus the State Labor Board, okay? It guarantees that I own my job just like you own your house, right? They can't come and repossess your house. Exactly.
Just
based
like
on
these guys' rights, effectively.
Correct. So, based on that and all the due process and everything that's supposed to go through, none of that has happened. The city has doubled down on everything. And at one point, we had over about 140 firefighters that were off duty, leave no pay, okay? Pending termination, violating all of your Skelly rights, violating all the due process and everything. Then we had a bunch of members that took an exemption and went back to work, okay? So, they put us off duty because we're an imminent threat to the workforce and to the public. But yet I can fill out an exemption, which I don't need because I have God-given rights, okay, that are protected and enshrined by the Constitution, Declaration of Independence, and the Bill of Rights. It gives me very specific rights. And especially in the state of California, Article 1, Section 1 protects my medical autonomy. Okay? It gives me right to privacy as far as testing and all that goes. They're violating all of these rights and they don't care. You say, get an attorney and go to court. We did. We've got John Howard, Scott Street, and Robert F. Kennedy as our attorneys, okay? We've filed multiple lawsuits, gone through the court system in Los Angeles. The judge that we have has showed complete bias in everything. It's unreal. We're trying to get him recused. refused and removed at this point. He's denied that we even have legal standing to file a lawsuit at this point and dismissed it. So now we're in the appeals process.
I was just going to say, you have to appeal that.
It's insane what is happening.
You just said right now, if you have due process rights, then you have them or you don't.
Right.
If you have them.
And when it's a Supreme Court ruling in the state of California, there is no question. It goes against a Supreme Court ruling. That's suicide, unless there's some sort of illusion or whatever. But the city and the county, I mean, here we are in the city of Los Angeles, the county of Los Angeles. Right now we're not there. But this becomes a political issue. This is not about my safety or your safety or whatever. Because if it was, the world would still be locked down. When I can drive across a county line into Riverside, San Bernardino, Orange, and everybody's open, and everybody, all the fire departments are hiring the people that are leaving the city of Los Angeles or being terminated, that's a partisan issue. That has nothing to do with my safety. Because if it did, this would be a totally different story, and everybody...
I would say it's a partisan issue.
It's a political issue.
It's a local issue, and you have different people looking at the issue different ways.
Okay.
Because you have, and the biggest example is the state of California versus the state of Florida. And you have a lot of Democrats who are with you. A lot of Democrats who are probably not with you. And so it's not a partisan issue. It's really, I think it's just one of your perception of what you need to do to protect yourself.
Absolutely.
And that's really it. I mean, you're going to look at it one way, I'm going to look at it another.
But you said something key right there. You said what you need to do to protect yourself. Personal freedom. That's what this country's founded on, right? The ability of free choice.
I agree with you on that.
But when this mask on the box even says does not protect against viruses, that thing is designed to keep in an operating room, in a sterile environment. That is designed to keep any respiratory particles from falling on that person, right? Am I missing something? It does not protect against a virus.
Well, I'll tell you why they probably put that on there.
This was before that. It's been on the box for a long time. It doesn't even protect against barely dust.
But it's been there before COVID, right?
Correct.
And you know why it's there before COVID?
Liability.
Liability.
Sure.
You put there because you don't want to be wearing a mask and you come down with something and sue the manufacturers because you made the assumption it was going to... You know,
is it Calder?
When we look at the size of a virus compared to a mold spore or dust particulate from a fire, none of those work. I mean, like Josh was saying earlier, N95 masks, we have to be fitted for those annually. We have to do a fit test on those. And every single time we do a fit test, it fails. They can't be fitted right. They don't protect. It's everything that is going on right now is a charade in that aspect.
I wouldn't call it a charade. I would call it the best practices with what you know about the virus.
So when Rochelle Walensky of the CDC comes out and says that the shot does not protect you from getting COVID and does not protect you from transmitting COVID, and when you look at how vaccines are made, right, they have a long time until they come to life. 15 years of study, level 1, level 2, level 3 trials. When you have all of those, and we're still in a level 3 trial, right? This is an emergency use authorization. When the head of the CDC is saying that it doesn't protect you, and it doesn't protect someone else, and then that vaccine or that shot that you're being administered was based on the Delta, not the Delta, but the original Omicron variant.
The way I understood it was the vaccine was there to reduce the symptoms.
But that's not the definition of a vaccine.
That's the best you got, given the time that you have to protect people.
That definition was changed on the website as well.
But if it protects the individual, right? So if it reduces symptoms, great. And if I take it, it reduces my symptoms, great. But what does it do for the other person? So why are we terminating people or threatening to terminate people, right?
Again, that's the issue right now that you need to hire an attorney on, and you sounds like you have.
We have
because this is also an issue of contractual law, employment law, cities, and why they hire you,
everything.
And why they pay you to do the job. I mean, you got a lot of issues that are wrapped up on, you know, I'm not a firefighter, I'm not a police officer, but I do what I need to do to make sure when I go up place to place, if I need to wear a mask, I wear it, because out of respect for people that have concerns. And, you know, I'll do it out of the abundance of caution. I already got COVID.
Same here, three times.
And I've had it once, I've had three vaccines, and I don't know if I'm going to get it again or not, but my hope is when I do get it, it doesn't take me down in a serious way.
And Lou, we're so, like, honored to have you here, because a lot of this goes on deaf ears, you know?
I just wanted to hear you out because, you know, this is a continuing discussion we're going to have. Yes. And we want to make sure that we continue to listen to your side
right.
as well. Okay.
I'd like to make a suggestion to you. There's a convoy that's currently in Englishtown, Maryland. And it's a peaceful convoy for the people, multiracial, African-Americans, whites, Latinos, people, LGBT, women.
Are you talking about the truck convoy?
It's not just trucks, there are more cars and trucks.
Okay.
And actually, we were part of it. We had a band that had liberals for freedom on it.
I don't think that you can draw any which way or possible as to right. who's there or who's not. It's a lot of people have concerns on this.
And what I found is there were a lot of people there with Democratic backgrounds, a lot of liberals there. And what I'd like you to do or consider is come out to the to Hagerstown, Maryland, to check out the convoy. You know, go there, you know, look at the people.
Well, I think I caught tailwind of them the other day when I was in Washington.
Hey.
But I want to continue to...
This is Mike here. He's co-founder of the convoy.
I've been quiet because the whole point of the convoy was for the people's voices to be heard, and that's what I watched here so far. So I guess what I'll say now is, since they all got to speak, is my name is Mike. I am one of the co-organizers of the people's convoy. Like she said, it's not just trucks. It's cars, campers, buses, all kinds of stuff. It's for the people, and it's not a right or a left thing. Like
this is
the
a serious issue.
People
trying
to make it right. It's an American issue, and I've heard something from everybody that has spoke here that has been an issue that we have had addressed throughout this whole thing. Right. So the whole point behind what we're doing comes down to our freedoms, right? Okay. And to get that, we need the Constitution. A lot of people don't know is because of the Emergency Act due to COVID. Constitution can be null and void at the hands of those in Washington if they choose to do so. So right now, with the Emergency Act in place, we technically could get in trouble for our convoy because they could say that we don't have the right to our First Amendment if they wanted to, okay? Through this, we've met with a lot of the doctors, okay, that have spoke out against this. And when you have someone like a doctor that spent money and years to get a medical license, and they're willing to put that on the line to speak up against something, that speaks volumes. Because not everybody is going to put their life on the line or their livelihood on the line for what's right or what's wrong. You have people like these fine gentlemen right here that have devoted their life to saving people that now, because of a vaccine, that the doctors that created it even say isn't good, right, have lost their jobs. Somebody could potentially die because these experienced guys aren't on the job anymore. We have that in the military. We see doctors that are being blackballed from the industry for speaking out. Like you just said, people try already today called to try and get his license revoked. Okay. We have people like Dr. Fauci, who's an investor in Moderna, who's never actually treated a patient like a real doctor, sitting here saying that we can't use drugs like, I'll say it, ivermectin and hydrochloroquine. No, we have to come up with something new. Why? Because Moderna's never had an approved drug until COVID, and he's an investor in it. There's people making money off this, but there's people dying at the same time, which means it's almost like murder for hire if you really want to get down to the nitty-gritty of it, and they need to be held accountable. So with the doctors and their science, everybody said trust the science in the beginning, their science can prove that the number of people that died never had to, that there are better ways to treat it, that the treatment that we are giving people can actually hurt them when not done properly or in the right amount of time. And we can use that to prove that we don't need the Emergency Act put in place anymore, get our Constitution back, and stop this tyrannical government. I heard him talk about the judge over there that basically seems like he doesn't care what anybody says, it's up to him. That's a pretty heavy gavel to drop if you're going to do it on your own personal beliefs and not what's right and what's wrong. And that is just one small example of our entire government that has been corrupted by this. And like I said, it's not just the left and not just the right. And I am actually extremely excited that you, being on the Democratic side, have come out to meet with us today, because a lot of the main media has spun this into a Trump rally or a right thing or whatever, and it's not that at all. And she's been a part of it from the beginning, so is Joel, and I'm glad to be here.
We haven't had
Calder a chance to talk. He's here.
Yeah.
Calder has not had a chance to talk.
I appreciate you being able to finally answer the box to be able to speak to somebody that can hear about our problem. But thankfully, I'm not as bad as her situation. But I was vaccinated about 5 or 6 months ago. And a little bit of background, I'm 19. Healthy. I've never had any underlying conditions before. But I got vaccinated. I got sick the night of. I was like, okay, you know, I was expecting this, and I got really bad chest pain.
Did you get the Moderna?
I got the Jane, the Johnson & Johnson. So I was expecting to get sick, but I got through it. A couple days later, I was like, okay, I'm good to go. And I'm a semi-professional athlete. I'm a race car driver. I go to the gym 5 days a week. So a couple days later, I go back to the gym, and I'm like, wow, these are the worst chest pains I've ever felt in my entire life. Hard time breathing. I get home, I called him, we wound up doing a bunch of blood work, didn't have any heart damage. I was like, okay, let's rest, I'll get better, I'll get through this. It got somewhat better over a month and a half. It never went away. I couldn't take my dog for a walk, I couldn't go for a run, and I'm somebody that's going to the gym 2 hours a day after working for 8 hours. So I'm somebody that's very active. A month and a half after getting vaccinated, I get COVID in January. So Omicron, and then everything that I had when I got vaccinated just exacerbated. Chest pain, short of breath, fatigue, dizzy when I stand up, I get lightheaded. I can't go down the stairs without feeling something still. Even 3.5 months later, I'm on the program of maybe I can do a 10-minute walk today. Maybe I can go to lunch today. Maybe I could come here and feel okay 3-4 months later. And the only things that have improved my situation at all are IVs, lots of vitamins, which isn't covered by insurance. So thank God my parents are in a fortunate situation where they can pay for those sort of things. And I have someone like Dr. Barke as a resource to really tell me what to do. Because if you threw me in a room in the beginning when I got vaccinated and just took rest and got COVID, I was sitting in my room psyching myself out. I'm not somebody that can describe to you what anxiety or stress is. Calling him once a week, saying my arm is tingling and my chest hurts, and he goes, calm down. 10 minutes later, I'll feel better. Somebody that has stress, anxiety, pains everywhere, can't breathe. Really the worst illness.
Are you getting any better?
Really slowly. So it's been 3 months, and like I said, this is a lot of effort just to stand and be here in my shape, and I can do a 10-minute walk, it's better. But it's taken 3-4 months just to be smidgen better.
It didn't take me as long, but I went to kind of do the same thing. And even today, like I said, once in a while, I'll just be talking and get that foggy feeling and just got to pull back.
Yeah, but I'm lucky I'm not super terrible, like some people that are just completely bedridden and it's got better. But
all of us know a lot of people that have died.
You would think, like, for example,
my dad's 94.
Yeah.
He got COVID. He's a rusty old union guy, and he's at home. I said, take me to the doc now. No, I'm okay. Finally, third day, okay, take me to the doc.
You think, like, for example, my parents, they're both in their 50s, and my dad's a little bit overweight, high blood pressure, and thank God my mom's good now, but went through chemotherapy and stage 4 lymphoma, and really only 2-3 months after getting off of chemotherapy, gets COVID, and she barely even knew she had it. My dad had it for like a week, was totally fine. Meanwhile, I've lost 30 pounds, can't breathe. And so this is the Omicron. A year ago, we got probably the Delta variant at that point too. I didn't even know I had the thing. It was for sure in my body because my parents had it for their first time and they were sick for 2 weeks. I was drinking out of the same glasses as them, sitting on the couch with them. I was tired for a day and my nose sniffled for a day. And then after getting vaccinated and getting the Omicron variant, it's like I'm ready to die.
Thank you very much. Anybody left to talk? Anybody else?
I do. Sorry, Tim, you haven't touched on. this something for you to think about. So those of us that did take the vaccine, okay, so they were mandated, they did what they were supposed to do, and now they're unable to do their job. They're unable to do their job because they can't get better, or they're not in my daughter or your position, you wouldn't be able to go back to work at this point.
I haven't worked in three
My
months.
Daughter can't go back to work. She's not working at the hospital anymore. But my point being, there is a large amount of people that did exactly what, I'm going to point you because you're government, you're standing at the government. Sure. But they did exactly what you asked to us to do. So we did. The government. But I'm going to say the royal you. So we did it. So now there are hundreds of thousands, and I can give you access to these people, so we do need to follow up, because I truly can help you see who these people are. No safety net. There is nobody out there helping them, because if doctors either can't, or they can't find you, or they're silenced, they're censored, so they can't even ask for help, right? So in my case, or in other people's case, they shouldn't be afraid to ask for help.
Are doctors silent?
No, patients that have been injured. I mean, they have the ability to come out.
I mean, we've been censured online talking to Ted Cruz and Ron Johnson. So
forget the online. I'm talking about.
No, they can come out. There's just not a lot of doctors that will listen to them.
They can't come out. I mean, nobody's going to.
Okay, so I got you. How are we going to come out? Who are we going to talk to?
There are a lot who actually have been ridiculed, censored, refused any support of any kind because they've been vaccinated.
I get you.
So it means that. So it means. Well, I guess I'll pull it back and I'll do it as fast as I can. Cause I can't
I think it means
we're going to the doctor all the different times. I went to I don't even know. I lost count of how many. Right. So we went. Couldn't figure out what's going on. We were gaslit, told maybe she needs whatever she's in her head. Not in her head because she's falling apart before us. My point is, how am I supposed to find a doctor to help? If I had breast cancer, there is Susan G. Coleman. There's a place to go for resources. If I was an alcoholic, there is a place to go. There is no resources. We are not allowed to ask for resources. We have none.
We have the resources. We don't give anybody there to help people like this.
Sure. I mean, there are doctors that have a variety of protocols to help both vaccinated and COVID-injured people. They're not easy to find, though.
There you go.
There's a lot of doctors that will treat you if you're not vaxxed.
There are a lot of doctors, but they're difficult to find because...
Jimmy Dore, I'm sure you know who he is because he's a comedian, very liberal. He was vax-injured, and he has been censored quite a bit as he talks about his vax-injuries.
Somebody's got a vaccine.
Yeah.
Who's injured.
Yes. We need to help them. Because there's people that have lost their jobs. They're losing their houses. I'm telling you, I have so much information for you, it's not even funny.
Not only that, we have people at the convoy that literally can't even get a biopsy on their lung done because they're not vaccinated.
Exactly.
It's kind of bizarre.
Let's do this. I'm going to follow up on the issue with the medical.
Your assistant has my card.
And I'm going to try to follow up the issue. As you said, somebody's had the vaccine, as you said. They took the vaccine, but nothing, and they're injured. What's next?
I printed this out to get to it. This is the Pfizer adverse reactions and the documentation for the first 3 months. I don't know if you have it, but it's a very interesting read. The last pages are 9 pages of all the possible adverse reactions.
Is this a 38-page document that was just
released? In the beginning, there's a little bit of a discussion where it breaks it down. For the first 3 months of what happened. It's an interesting read in any way.
Judge McGroon, who's in Senate, Anna would like you to follow up with her. Her daughter was forced to get the vaccine because she's a healthcare worker.
I'm sorry?
Joyce McGroon, she lives in Santa Ana. Her daughter is a healthcare worker.
Joyce McGroon.
She's forced to get
the photo?
She's also got heart problems as a result of the vaccine and can't even have an operation.
Here, we can take this side here.
Shots fired.
You guys can in there, please.